हेलो, आई एम डॉक्टर मोहम्मद आसिफ। आई वेलकम यू टू माय चैनल। आई विल डिस्कस स्टडीइंग लिटरेचर, चेंजिंग पर्सपेक्टिव्स एंड हाउ दीज चेंजिंग पर्सपेक्टिव्स हैव अफेक्टेड द आइडिया ऑफ लिटरेचर। इन दिस वीडियो आई विल डिस्कस द फॉलोइंग आइटम्स। नंबर वन, सम जनरल क्वेश्चंस अबाउट लिटरेचर, लिविस मेथड, चेंजिंग एटीट्यूड्स, intrinsic versus extrinsic approaches, postmodern deaths, and at the end, death of idea of literature. Now I will discuss some important questions related to literature. First is, what is literature? There is no single definition, and literature has been defined differently in different ages. And every age has tried to define literature according to its own requirements. Why do we study literature? Generally, we say that we study literature in order to better know life and humanity. But this is not as simple. We study European literature especially because it is part of our syllabi, that it is a colonial legacy, and had there been no colonizers, perhaps we might not have been studying the literature that we usually study. So studying literature is not as simple as it appears. What is the role of literature in life? What is the role of literature in life? For some people, it might be a leisure and pleasure activity. But if we look at human history, especially of the last 400 years, literature has shaped the destiny of the multitude in the whole world. Does literature reflect, mirror society? Yes, literature does reflect or mirror society, but then differently. Traditionally, it was believed that literature reflects only the higher values, only the best ideals of our society. But now in contemporary era, we believe that literature also reflects the politics, the race consciousness, the gender bias, and other related issues as well. So in this way, literature does reflect society in all of its complexity. Does literature construct society? Yes, literature also constructs society. How should we study literature? Now, this is a very political question. Can we study literature just for the sake of it, for some pleasure, for some entertainment, or for some knowledge? Or should we study literature very critically, focusing on the politics of the text as well? Is Shakespeare relevant today? This very question shows that something drastic has happened to the reputation of once mighty bard Shakespeare, that Shakespeare's relevance is being questioned in today's world. Now I will discuss Lewis method, traditional approach. F.R. Lewis is known for his normative analysis of literature, and his approach towards literature was basically humanist, and he had a very high conception of literature. So let's see what he says about literature. The study of literature has a civilizing mission to humanize people and provide values. This is a humanist principle. The humanists believed in an edifying role of literature, that literature should cultivate morals and values, that literature should promote ethics. This civilizing mission and the mission to humanize people was actually used to dehumanize people living in the former colonies of the European Empire. A text can and should be studied objectively. Now, this focus on objectivity was a major critical tool that was employed by the Western critics to promote their own culture and literature and undermine the literature and culture of the other countries. The reader must demonstrate sensibility or an individual response to the text, which happens naturally when a literary text is read. This is again an elitist approach, because sensibility was not considered to be accessible to the ordinary individuals. It was supposed to be exclusively or an exclusive domain of the educated people of the elite class. And when we focus on the word naturally, it meant only that this sensibility would come naturally only to the privileged class. And the underprivileged class, and especially the people who are not part of the Western culture or who are the cultural others of the West, it cannot come to them naturally. Lewis method, practical criticism, also known as close reading. Lewis focused on practical criticism, and his focus on practical criticism meant that he did not want his readers to study literature in wider context, that they should not go for Marxist criticism, and they should not try to unearth and unravel the political context of the text in which a text is written. There is a canon or authoritative list of great literary works. This literary canon was actually very exclusive and discriminatory. It was mostly white European male dominated, and it did not represent any other, neither the European female writers, and there is no question of inclusion of any author from any other part of the world. A literary text is free from history and time and has intrinsic worth. So this is a formalist approach that is no longer tenable. Understanding the changes. Now I will focus on some of the changes that have taken place in studying literature. First, act of interpretation is not a natural process. Act of interpretation is actually a very critical process, and in contemporary scenario, it is a very cultural, political, and ideological process. No interpretation is neutral or objective. Interpretation is affected by the context in which you read. Everyone is located in the world. Everyone is different. So the whole act of interpretation has undergone a revolution. Now interpretation has become a very critical and very political activity in which the context of the reader has become more important. Now reader writes the text. Now reader interprets the text according to his own context. Critical attitudes. Where should we start with thinking about how we read? So this is the question that every reader should ask oneself. One should know one's own ideology and culture, and one should know one's own convictions and biases and prejudices. And once one has delimited one's own context, then one should proceed on reading whatever one likes to read. Now there are two attitudes towards studying literature. First is what is intrinsic attitude, and second is what is extrinsic attitude. How do you approach a text? Now, answer to these questions will show where you stand and how you look at literature and how you study it. Do you look at it as a beautifully woven fabric of language or as an example of writing which tells you about the historical period in which it was written? Is it stimulating because it puts words together in a new way, or because it pours out on paper the intense experiences and interesting ideas of a particular writer? Do we study literary works for their pure artistic merit, or because they reveal things about the world and their authors? So if your answer to any of these questions and all of these questions is yes, that you believe that all these questions, they should be answered affirmatively, then your approach is traditional. Because in traditional approach, we believe that the authors, they are unique, that they have unique personalities, that their experiences and emotions are unique, that their expression is also unique, that they are like prophets and they reveal real things about the life and the world. And if we believe in all these things, then our approach is definitely traditional. and we need to question our own reading. Now I come to intrinsic attitudes. It is into the text. The intrinsic attitude is often called formalism. Focus is on choice of metaphors, the use of symbols, structure, style, contrast, images, the development of plot, what a text means. Formalism focuses on the words on the page. Formalism focuses on the text. Formalism privileges defamiliarization and literary devices, but it ignores context. The political context of the author and the reader of the text, and it does not focus on the role or agenda of the text. Now we can compare intrinsic attitudes with extrinsic attitudes. In intrinsic attitude, we focus on the text. We delve into the text to find out the structures that make the text and that produce the meaning. In the extrinsic attitude, we focus on the context of the text. Intrinsic attitude, it is flat, that it gives you just one view, whereas in extrinsic attitude, text becomes a window to the world and offers many perspectives and many avenues to explore the text and the world and life and to have a look at the world from different angles. Literature is worth studying in its own right. It uses language in a unique way. And in extrinsic, literature is worth studying for what it tells us about other things. So this is formalist approach, and this is, you may call, non-formalist approach, the approach that focuses on other aspects of the text. Great texts are the focus because they have artistic and possibly the moral worth. So in traditional perspective or from the formalist perspective, we promote an exclusive elitist literary canon. And in extrinsic attitude, we don't focus on the great texts. Rather, any sort of text is worthy of study as they all reveal the world. Intrinsic attitudes versus extrinsic attitudes. In intrinsic attitude, our approach is formalist. And in extrinsic attitudes, our approach is historicist, rather new historicist and cultural materialist. And in intrinsic attitude, when we focus on formalism, we focus on words on the page. And in extrinsic attitude, when our approach becomes historicist and new historicist, we focus on the context. And in the formalist perspective, we focus on meaning in the text. And in new historicist perspective, we focus on the context, and we believe that it is the larger social cultural context that produces the meaning. Intrinsic approaches are practical criticism, close reading, and new criticism. Extrinsic approaches are historicism, new historicism, cultural materialism, postmodernism, post-structuralism, psychoanalytical criticism, post-colonial criticism, feminism, critical race theory, etc. Postmodern deaths. Now I will discuss some important deaths in the postmodern context, and these deaths have been more dangerous than the actual deaths of the human beings. First is death of God. This is from Nietzsche. Nietzsche believed that Christian God is dead, that Christianity as a religion has failed, and Christianity cannot solve the problems of humanity. And in this way, this dictum, death of God, resulted in secularism, atheism, and the contemporary humanism. Death of author. This is from Roland Barthes, and this is a structuralist idea that these are the deep structures, invisible structures, that create the work, and it is not the exclusive domain of the author. Marxists and new sources also deny agency to the author. Marxists believe that material conditions produce the text, whereas new sources believe that it is the culture that produces the text, that the authors, they have a very limited role in creating the text. Death of meaning, death of meaning in the sense that there is no final meaning, that meaning as a sacred entity is no longer tenable, that there is no single meaning, that there is no finality, then that meaning is cultural and ideological, and there is nothing that we can pinpoint as absolute or exclusive meaning of any word. Death of critic, this is important. The critics were believed to be unique, and if we look at history of literary criticism, all the major critics, they had their own concepts, they had their own terminologies. Like Aristotle promoted the terms like imitation and gave his own law of probability and necessity, three unities, etc. Then we come to William Wordsworth. He talks of spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings and emotions. Then we come to Matthew Arnold. He talks of disinterestedness. And then we come to T.S. Eliot. He talks of objective correlative tradition and so many things. When we look back at all these things, we come to know that all these critics, they were individual in the traditional sense, that they had claims to exclusive understanding of literature from their personal perspective, and they were in a position to give very individualistic opinions on literature. Now in contemporary era, this is no longer tenable, because now we live in the age of theory, and all those who read and apply theory, they have to follow the terms and terminologies given by the theory that they follow, and they have no choice. Death of grand narrative, this is from Lightoff, and Lightoff says alternative narratives are as important as are the grand narratives. Death of center, though Derrida did not say this exactly the same way, he just talked of decentering, but we can rephrase his philosophy as death of center. Center for Derrida meant logos, that Western philosophy stood on logos, or it is logocentric. And he says that in the post-structuralist scenario, this center has been decentered, and there is no center, and there are no bases on which philosophy can stand. Death of real, it comes from Baudrillard, and some critics say that death of real has real consequences for humanity and far greater consequences than death of God as pronounced by Nietzsche. Now, what is real? The real is referent. And if referent is death, it means there is no reality outside the text. In other words, reality is only representation. And still, in other words, reality is only textual. And more importantly, Baudrillard says that now representation precedes reality. Death of discipline. This is actually a title of one of Spivak's book. And death of discipline is a postmodern idea that there are no longer tight-jacketed differences between different disciplines. Death of Shakespeare. Shakespeare has become very controversial in the post-colonial perspective. Harold Bloom grudgingly admits in his introduction to The Tempest that the post-colonial critics have assumed that Shakespeare is dead, that practically Shakespeare is no longer relevant, and studying Shakespeare actually reminds them of their colonial experiences, and Shakespeare's works were part and parcel of the European civilizing mission. Challenges to literature. So following are the challenges to literature. First, to cope with a highly ideologically charged world. Number two, an assertive other that has put self on the defensive. Number three, how to sell sympathy and empathy in the absence of traditional terminology. Now, earlier literature was promoted using terms like objectivity, universality, human nature, that literature promotes humanity and things like that. Now, these terms, they have become redundant in the contemporary, postmodern, and postcolonial era, and it will be very difficult for the writers to promote the same traditional values in the absence of the traditional terminology. Now I will discuss the most important question, idea of literature. Death of idea of literature. If we believe in the traditional view of literature, that literature is a layer and player reading, that literature promotes human values, that literature is objective, that literature does not have any agenda, or writers, they are very innocent, and writers are not the product of the culture or history in which they live, and they go beyond the limits and limitations of their own age, gender, class, race, region, religion, and then they address the whole humanity. Or same literature can be studied in the same perspective world over. If we believe in all these things, then this literature that in which you believe, that is dead. There is no room for a literature that can be studied with the same perspective in the same context by the whole humanity. Literature is no longer a civilizing or humanizing tool. It is no longer exponent of human nature. It does not promote universality, and literature is not a messiah. And if we look at the history of last 400 years, we believe that literature had played a very negative role in shaping the destiny of the nations. Now, in the changed perspective, literature should come with cautionary note. It should contain a description, prescription, and caution. The description should state who is the author. It should give context of the work, ideology, gender, race, class, religion, and region. Whether the author is white, European, Christian, secular, capitalist, male, it should answer all these questions, and they should be on the title page. Then there should be prescription, and prescription should read like this. This literary work is written in this perspective. The writer should make his perspective very clear, and it is meant for this audience. He should also make clear his intended audience. It can be dangerous for this audience, and he should make it clear that this is not meant for this kind of audience and they may not study it. Caution, the other should not study the literature of self without the guidance of an expert. Strategies, literature is a very important record of human conscious and unconscious. Literature reflects the unconscious of the society, and the unconscious never lies. Literature should be studied critically with an eye on everything going in the text, its context and non-context. Critical reading of literature can be a very edifying and rewarding experience. So the final recommendation is that literature should be studied very critically and with open eyes and mind. Thank you.